Hello viewers, we are going to start a new series of lectures on cosmetics and perfumes. And in this series, today in the first session, we shall talk about that what are cosmetics, and we shall take one important hair care product, shampoo, in detail today. Now, what are cosmetics? Then we will discuss anatomy of skin and hair. Because most of the cosmetics, they are applied to the skin or to hair. Then, as I said, that we shall discuss shampoo in detail today. We will discuss what are the ideal properties of a good quality shampoo, how shampoos are classified, then what are the basic ingredients of shampoo, formulation of a common shampoo. In this, we will take up that what are the basic ingredients, minimum amount of these things, but different companies which they supply, they have different formulations. Then conditioners, these are the substances which can be used separately as well as they are added to the shampoo also. We shall discuss briefly the cleansing action of shampoo. Then what are the quality tests for a shampoo, those should be performed by any company, and can there be any adverse effect of shampoo, and finally we will summarize our today's work. Although cosmetics existed since the origin of civilization for the purpose of beautifying, perfuming, cleansing or rituals, but a great progress has been made in the diversification of the products and functions only in the 20th century. Now, in earlier times, they were not known by the term cosmetics, but people were applying different type of substances on their faces or on the skin to beautify the body. Cosmetics are defined as the products which are intended to be applied to the human body for cleansing, beautifying, promoting attractiveness, or altering the appearance without affecting the body structure or function. This is the definition that provides the classification of any substance, whether it is cosmetic or not. Currently, cosmetics also intend to benefit their target, whether it is the skin, hair, nail or tooth. Every second day, we see an advertisement of a product that this is age defying cream or anti wrinkle cream, or this is the cream which will strengthen the hair, all these things. Companies are adding some substances which in a way benefit these parts. Then shampoos, hair color, sprays, skin care creams and lotions, talcum and face powders, lipsticks, fingernails, polishes, eye and facial makeup, etc. These type of products, they are all included under cosmetics, like deodorants and perfumes, baby products, bath oils, bubble baths, mouthwashes, etc. Cosmetics that make therapeutic claim are also regulated as drugs and cosmetics. The examples of the product that are both cosmetics and drugs are dandruff shampoos, fluoride toothpaste that fight tooth decay, antiperspirants and deodorants, sun blocking or sunscreen preparations. So, these type of products, they are covered under Drug and Cosmetic Act. Now, since as I said that these cosmetic products are applied on the skin, we must have some idea about the anatomy of the skin. Without going into the details of the biology of this, I will briefly take up what is skin, how it is made up. Skin is the outermost covering of the vertebrates, and it consists of three layers. The first outermost layer is called epidermis, and it provides the waterproofing barrier and creates our skin tone. The next part, that is from here to here, this portion, this is called dermis. Beneath the epidermis, it contains tough connective tissues, hair follicles, sweat glands, etcetera, they are all present in this portion of the skin. And then the lowermost portion of the skin is called hypodermis, which is further deeper, and it contains mainly fat tissues and connective tissues. Only epidermis is exposed to all the cosmetic products. An average square inch of skin holds about 650 sweat glands, 20 blood vessels, 60,000 melanocytes, and more than 1,000 nerve endings. Then we should have the brief idea about the anatomy of the hair also. This hair grows out of the skin, but hair are present only on the soft skin. The hard skin, like palm of the hand, there are no hair on it. Hair has along with it the sebaceous glands, from where the sebum, a product, is constantly oozing out, and the keeps hair shining. Then the hair strand itself consists of three parts. The inner part is called medulla, then next is the cortex, that consists the major thickness of this hair strand, and then their outer layer, cuticle. The cuticle is a flaky surface, it consists of flakes, as we have the scales on the fish skin. So, this is briefly about the anatomy of hair and skin. Now, let us move on to the first hair care product, shampoo. A shampoo is a hair care product typically in the form of viscous liquid that is used to clean the scalp and hair to remove dirt, sweat, dandruff, pollutants, and other greasy residues, including oils or lotions which have been previously applied to head. The skin on our head produces a greasy fluid called sebum. It is produced to protect the hair by coating itself all over the head. This gives the hair a healthy shine, but when secreted in large amount, it makes the hair look dirty. Historically, the term shampoo is believed to be derived from the Hindi word champu, which means to press or massage. Modern shampoo, as it is known today, was first introduced in 1930s. Modern shampoo means the shampoo containing a synthetic detergent and not the soap. Now, shampoos are also supposed to have a secondary function, which serves to condition and beautify hair. As I said before, that certain conditioners are also mixed along with the shampoos. Then, a good quality shampoo should have the following properties. It should make the hair smooth and shiny, produce good amount of foam, should not cause irritation to scalp, skin, and eye. It should completely and effectively remove dirt. It should impart a pleasant fragrance to hair. Then it should have good biodegradability, that is, when it is washed out, then it should be a biodegradable product, have low toxicity, slightly acidic, pH less than 7, since a basic environment weakens the hair by breaking the disulfide bonds in hair keratin. So, that is why the pH of most of the shampoos is kept around 6. Then shampoos can be present in different forms. They are classified as powder shampoo, liquid shampoo, lotion shampoo, cream shampoo, jelly shampoo, and aerosol shampoo. They can be applied in any form, but the most commonly used form is the liquid shampoo. Then shampoos, as I said, can have some specialized functions also, and such shampoos are classified as conditioning shampoo if they have conditioners mixed with it, anti-dandruff shampoo if they contain an anti-dandruff substance, baby shampoo. These should be very soft shampoos applied only for small babies, and then two-layer shampoos. The basic ingredient of any shampoo is basically a detergent. The first thing is water, and it contains a detergent, or we also call as surfactants. The most commonly used detergents are ammonium lauryl sulfate, sodium lauryl sulfate, and sodium laureth sulfate. These are the structure for sodium lauryl sulfate. It is obtained from a tool carbon chain, lauric acid, and then sulfonate derivative, and then with an ether linked with it, it is called sodium laureth sulfate. Then second are foam boosters. Foam boosters are also sometimes called as secondary detergents. They are basically again detergents, but they help to increase the amount of foam and the size of the bubbles. So that shampoo should be a foamy product. Then next are the thickeners. Most commonly thickeners used are carboxy, methyl cellulose or even ionic substances like sodium chloride or ammonium chloride. Then conditioning agents, silicones such as methicone are the most commonly used conditioning agents these days. Otherwise some quaternary ammonium salts are also used as conditioning agent. The other ingredients are preservatives. Preservatives are added to the shampoo to increase the shelf life, and most of these substances are basically either antibacterial or antifungal substances. Then we add anti-dandruff agents like selenium sulfide or pyrethone, salicylic acid, etc. pH buffers. As I said that pH of the shampoo should be around 6. So, most commonly substance which is added is citric acid to lower the pH in slightly acidic range. Then in the shampoos, there are certain other substances which are added called aesthetic additives. These are added for presentability, marketability and stability of the product, such as colorants. Different companies give a light pink color or light green color, etcetera, to the shampoo. Some keep it colorless. Then some UV absorbers are also added, so that when this shampoo is slightly kept adsorbed on the hair, so they can be protected from the UV light. Then some opacifiers are added. Some shampoos are opaque and substances are added which give them the pearly look. One of the compound which is used is EGDS, it is ethylene glycol distearate. Then fragrance substances like lemonin, ethyl isovalerate or other substances are also added. Then some sequestering agents are added. One of the common sequestering agent is EDTA, it is ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, and you know that it forms chelates with the calcium or magnesium ions which are present in hard water. So, shampoos can be used in hard water also. Then cocamidopropyl betaine, this is one of the detergent which is used as secondary detergent. As I said, the secondary detergents are added to boost the foam and also to make the shampoo slightly thicker. This is the substance which is obtained basically from coconut oil, and it is not a single substance. There may be a different acid chain on this side, but this is the acid part, and it is obtained by the reaction between dimethyl amino propyl amine. This is the portion here, dimethyl amino, and then there are three carbon and NH2 here, amine. They hydrolyze the coconut oil, and this portion combines with the acid part, glycerin is separated out, and these amides which are obtained on this side, they are further treated with chloroacetic acid, and we get this substance which is a zeutter ionic detergent, means it has a positive charge part as well as a negatively charged part here. So, this is one of the very commonly used secondary detergent. Then it has got some special properties due to which it is used in shampoos. It is milder on the skin, so adding it to the mix reduces the amount of the harshness of the detergent. It is thicker than other ingredients, so it can be added to make the mix have the right viscosity. It has anti-static properties, so the hair does not generate an electric charge and jump to the plastic combs and brushes used when drying the hair. It is a humectant, attracting moisture from the air, thus keeping hair from drying out perfectly. And lastly, it has antibiotic properties that can prevent spoiling of the shampoo. So, many purposes are served by adding this as a secondary detergent along with the primary detergent, which are mostly sodium lauryl sulfate or laureth sulfate as I discussed before. This table shows the formulation of a common shampoo, although different companies have different ratio for the products, but a basic shampoo, what it should have? It should have a detergent which is sodium lauryl sulfate around 15%, then cocamide DEA and then cocamidopropyl betaine 2% each, some fragrance, preservatives, citric acid, sodium chloride, color, and remaining is the water. These are the basic requirements for a shampoo. Then, as I said, we add conditioners to the shampoo, but what are conditioners? The hair conditioning is ingredient functions to impart manageability, gloss, and anti-static properties to the hair. This may be included in the shampoo, which then serves dual purpose of cleansing and conditioning. Sometimes some companies they sell conditioners separately also, which can be applied after the shampoo has been washed out. These are useful for those wishing to shampoo daily and for dry, damaged or chemically treated hair. Commonly used conditioning substances include hydrolyzed silk or animal protein, glycerin, dimethicone or other silicones, and then polyvinyl pyrrolidone or propylene glycol, etc. You can see in this picture that what will be the effect of a conditioner. If there is no conditioner, then hair may be like this, but once the conditioner is applied, then they settle down so easily and they can be combed easily also. Let us briefly discuss about the cleansing action of shampoo. The cleansing action of shampoo is not different what you have studied as the cleansing action of soap or detergents in your chemistry part. The surfactant molecules present in shampoo have a hydrophilic head and a hydrophobic tail. This hydrophobic tail is basically lipophilic, means it has a liking for the lipid portion, oil, etc. When we apply shampoo and water to the hair and generate lather, the hydrophilic end is drawn towards water while the tail is drawn towards the grease and oil on the hair and scalp. The oil and grease contains dirt and skin particles which are attached there. At high concentration, the surfactants form micelle. When shampooing, anionic surfactants containing hydrophobic tail gets adsorbed to grease or dirt of the hair, thus these dirts are removed by further rinsing. This is the SLS, sodium lauryl sulfate. This is the end, which is hydrophilic end. This is the carbon chain, which is hydrophobic end. We can just represent it with a small area, which is hydrophilic part, and this orange chain part, which is hydrophobic part. When this shampoo is applied on the hair strand, this is the hair strand which has this yellow layer indicating the oil, and this is the hair strand. The shampoo molecules, when they come near it, then they get attached to this the oily layer through the hydrophobic tail. Then they orient like this, and this is because the tail likes oil and the head of the SLS, the blue part, like water, and it sticks out. Then they form micelles like this, and then they are washed away with water, and we have a clean hair strand left. Then there are certain quality tests for the shampoo before it is sold in the market. These must be checked. After the shampoo formula is developed, it is tested to ensure that its quality will minimally change over time, and to ensure that the shampoo is safe for using, some of the tests are listed below. Foam and foam stability test means it should form foam and the foam should be stable. Then detergency and cleansing action, that how efficient it is in cleansing action. Then there is no eye irritation. Oral toxicity, if by chance it is inhaled or taken away in the body, it should not be toxic to the human. And then pH test, pH should be in acidic range. Skin irritation test, that it should not be irritable to the skin. And viscosity measurement, should have proper viscosity. Then shampoos sometimes can have the adverse effect also, depending upon the quality of the skin of a person. Adverse reaction to shampoos and conditioners are rare. It is known that a pH higher than 5.5 may cause irritation to the scalp. In the hair itself, damage to the hair shaft can occur if the wrong kind of shampoo is consistently applied with respect to the type of hair a person has, especially if no conditioners are applied for protection and restoration. And then reports of the allergic or irritant contact dermatitis, etcetera, are there when there are certain other type of substances, and then there may be a nose and eye irritation and delayed wound healing. These things depend from person to person, but normally shampoos do not have much allergic action or the negative effect on human being. Let us summarize what we have discussed today. We started with the introduction to cosmetics, that what are the substances which can be categorized under cosmetics. Then we discussed briefly the anatomy of the skin and hair to which most of the cosmetics are applied. Then we started discussing an important hair care product, which is shampoo. We discussed the ideal properties of shampoo, then how they are classified, what are the basic ingredients of shampoos, then formulation of a common shampoo. We discussed about conditioners, cleansing action of shampoo, that is how shampoo cleans the hair, and what are the quality tests for shampoo. Now, in our next session, we will discuss about another hair care product, that is hair dye, and also hair sprays. Thank you.